much for your being here. Let's begin with our panel, Miki Kiyoshi and Cassirer and Ricœur. Here we have Mr. Steve G. Lofts from Canada. He is a professor at the Department of Philosophy at University College, Canada. His primary area of research is European philosophy in general and the Neo-Kantian tradition, with a special focus on Ernst Cassirer. He has published a number of books on Cassirer and translated a large portion of his work into English. At this moment, he is working on the proofs of a new translation of Cassirer's philosophy of symbolic forms. His interest in Japanese philosophy and the Kyoto school was sparked a few years ago as he was working on a book on Cassirer and Heidegger. While doing research, stay in Japan, he decided to start a book project on the relationship between Neo-Kantian thought, Cassirer, and the Kyoto school tradition. Thank you for your being here. So,
well, thank you for the introduction. I didn't know, I mean, I knew that, but I didn't know you knew that. I didn't know anybody else knew that, some of that. I thank you for the organizers. Having organized a number of my conferences myself, I know how much work they are and how important they are, and the work that organizers do should just be constantly thanked at every stage you can. So thank you for the organizing this. Disclaimer, I'm a new person to Japanese philosophy. I would say that what I know about Japanese philosophy, you could write on a good postcard. I'll be generous, a postcard. It used to be the stamp, but now a postcard. So please forgive me if I say things that are either grammatically incorrect, linguistically incorrect, or just philosophically wrong. Next disclaimer, I wrote a paper for this conference, and then I decided not to read it, and I wrote a new paper today, and I will try to make clear why I did that and what I'm doing. So this is really, literally, I wrote this today, so wish me luck. I have a new title. It's called A New Beginning, Creative Freedom and Radical Politics. In the logic of the imagination, let me get it, because I have no idea how long I'm going to be. In the logic of the imagination, Miki states, quote, "We can say that the logic of the imagination is the logic of symbols. What Cassirer refers to as the philosophy of symbolic forms needs to be rewritten in accordance with the logic of the imagination." My original paper provided a close comparison between Miki and Cassirer's respective accounts of myth, going through blow by blow, showing where they connect, etc. And it did so by taking up John Crummell's suggestion that we should situate Miki's analysis as an investigation of the mythologicalization of Japanese ideology. And therefore, I wanted to connect it to Cassirer's own account in the myth of the state, which he calls the technology of artificial myths, that he thought was at the foundation of National Socialism. However, as I was writing and as I was working, some questions continued to haunt me. First, Heidegger's absence. It's unimaginable that Miki was not aware of the Kant book, of the debate between Cassirer and Kant, or Heidegger, over the role of the productive imagination. And so in a book that says the logic of the imagination, to talk about Cassirer and not Heidegger, just why is Heidegger not there? So Heidegger's absence. Second, what was Miki really trying to do here? What is his intervention? What is he adding that he doesn't think is there? And two, or three, why in the world does he think that Cassirer's philosophy of symbolic forms has to be rewritten in accordance with the logic of the imagination, given that Cassirer repeatedly makes it clear that the philosophy of symbolic forms, that the logic of the symbolic is his version of the logic of the imagination? He says it in the Voss with Heidegger, and he says it throughout his publications, repeatedly. I mean, I have a series of quotes here, but let's not read them. Let's just trust that I'm correct there. Then, a couple of days ago, I was called in to be an external reader on a thesis on Heidegger, an emergency. The external reader had disappeared off the face of the earth, and I needed somebody to read the dissertation, and so I agreed. The candidate, at one point in the thesis, in one of the chapters, goes on about the creative transformation of Dasein. And I thought, in being in time, within the framework of being in time, there is no possibility of transforming Dasein. It's not a possibility. There can be no creativity in being in time. And the penny dropped. And I got on a plane, I came over here, and en route, I reread my project and felt that it was missing something essential and that I could give a better answer to all of my questions. So I reread it, reworked it, and decided to take the chance to change the paper. So, a new beginning. Here we go. The point, it seems to me now, in Miki's work, is that he is providing a militant defense of a notion of what I'm going to call radical creative freedom as the foundation for a project of radical creative politics. Traditionally, freedom has been either understood as or articulated as some type of stoic-like freedom from hegemony, as a retreat inward that can save the self but cannot change the world. Or, in the modern social political thought, it is understood as a freedom to, not only to act, but to be autonomous. That is, to be the urground or the ground of one's own world and history. The social political institutions are subsequently designed and configured to secure or establish these notions of freedom. The problem is that both the Stoic cannot change the world and the modern who works in the world can't even get out to the world. And this is the problem that Kant has, and Foucault just, I think, makes it even more difficult. The question in Kant is how to exercise freedom in a world of determinacy. That's the question. I'm free inside, but how do I get outside? And I don't think that we've answered that question. The whole modern project of Bildung was essentially this project. And it goes, you can trace it back to Pico. In Pico, transforms the nature of the human being such that we can become more angelic or more bestial based on Bildung, based on education or formation, the form according to a divine image or a divine model of goodness. So this auto-formation through Bildung is both a process and an outcome. It is a cultivation or a cultivating of the self. And this leads to the politics of culture. Now, by the time we get to the early 20th century, we have a decline in the divine image. And we have Foucault, or versions of Foucault, and we understand that power or discourse acts upon not our individuality, but along our possibilities, and that freedom now becomes a field of possibilities in which I can choose, but I'm not free to choose the possibilities. I can't determine the possibilities. So I can do Mac or PC, I can drink Coke or Pepsi, but that's it. My freedom is now inscribed within that structure. Miki's provides an alternative notion of freedom as radical creative freedom. By radical, I mean originary. By creative, I mean creative as in the divine creation and not productive. Production is just a continual producing, it's not creative. So I want to use a strict distinction. And therefore it is an ontological freedom and not just an ontic freedom. What is more, I think he is arguing for a form of radical creative politics based upon this radical creative freedom. That is to say, he wants to create a politics or a mode of doing politics that works upon, in a positive way, the formation of the structure. And he wants to ground this in the productive imagination, and as it is an imminent transcendence into the sheer possibility of nothing. Of course, there's your Miki coming in. In Miki's logic of the imagination, So Miki's logic of the imagination is implicitly, whether it was meant or not, a fundamental critique of Heidegger's project of philosophy, at least as it is spelled out in Being and Time and in the Kant book. The later Heidegger, that's another question, I don't think he had knowledge of that. And it is done through a critique of an interpretation of the productive imagination that is in direct conflict with Heidegger's. As you all know, at Davos, Cassirer and Heidegger debated the role of the productive imagination in Kant. Both recognize the importance of the productive imagination, however, have very different interpretations of how it works and what they do with it. I'm not going to enter into that, in part because, I'm not going to enter into it. Now, a word about methodology. Miki's work, he says, is a phenomenology that leads to a logic. So it is a Hegelian phenomenology which starts here and then eventually, like in Hegel, would lead to the development of a logic. The phenomenology for Hegel is a ladder. It's supposed to take common sense consciousness or understanding up to the realm of reason. Cassirer, at Davos and in his work, follows the activity of the productive imagination up the ladder to its highest manifestations in the production of ideas and thought. Heidegger, for his part, descends down the ladder to determine the ground of the productive imagination, which he roots in the finite temporality of Dasein. Cassirer speaks of the productive imagination as a pure spontaneity, whereas Heidegger will speak of the productive imagination as a receptive spontaneity, therefore being finite. Heidegger makes an observation that I think is correct. While the terminus ad quem of Cassirer's work is clear, the terminus ad quo is entirely problematic, left out. And Cassirer recognizes this and says he doesn't care. That's not his project. Miki, one, cannot accept Heidegger's interpretation and the limitations it sets upon the productive imagination. He is repeatedly clear on this point. Pure spontaneity. There is no limitations on spontaneity. He must have this for other reasons. Two, Miki goes both up and down the Hegelian ladder. He follows the productive imagination to the grounding of theory, thoughts, and ideas on the one hand, while at the same time provides the ground for the productive imagination that guarantees its autonomy, and so it is truly radical and originary. Three, because he does both-way movement, he is able to provide a ground for political agency that is sadly lacking in Cassirer, and that is lacking in modern philosophy, and that is lacking today. Let us turn to a quick reading of chapter one of the Logic of the Imagination on Myth, and focus on Miki's contributions to the Logic of the Imagination. So what is he adding that is not already in Cassirer? In section one, Miki begins by situating his project in the problematic, to retrieve the idea of the Logic of the Imagination. He does this immediately with reference to Cassirer. If we return to the Cassirer's text, Cassirer makes this argument in three different places over a span of 30 years, so it was very important. He makes the exact same point in three different places, including an essay in the main. If we return to the text, we see that the project and problematic Miki outlines in section 1 follows almost exactly Cassirer's own lead. Though it takes a more radical stance. So the setting out of different types of logic, a logic that must be other than the logic of formal logic, of rational thought, etc. So it's the exact same problematic. How can you guarantee the sort of dignity of the logic of the imagination? So, Miki distinguishes, following Cassirer, between formal logic of abstract rational thought, on the one hand, and the concrete logic, which will be the logic of the imagination, which will then, of course, be understood in terms of a logic of action, and the logic of action will in turn be understood as a logic of creativity, and the logic of creativity will in turn be understood as the logic of history from the standpoint of making history. And I emphasize the making history in the terms of the historical context in which Miki lived. The question about the questions that were before them. The pre-existence of the idea, Miki then goes on to say later in the text, means if there is a pre-existence of the idea, no creativity is possible. So where there is the idea already exists, no creativity is possible. Why? Because the idea is the end and not the beginning of the creative process. History is the unfolding of the creative imagination and not the unfolding of the idea. The idea is an abstraction from the image of the imagination. It is the symbol of the image. Thus, the images of the imagination are not the symbols of thought, but rather the inverse. Thought is the symbols of the image. In all these ways, he is putting the productive imagination at the heart and at the foundation of everything, and inverting at the same time much of the Western structure. In myth, following Cassirer, the image and thing are one. Myth is an ontological structure. It is concerned with a certain way of being of beings, the being of beings. It is the living form of history. Now, Miki, like Cassirer, distinguishes between the mere narrative dimension of myth, that which is closest to the rational thought, etc., and the real core of myth, which is situated in the writ and ritual. The writ and ritual is a praxis. It possesses an effect of realizing a true symbolism between the totem tribe and its totem, what Cassirer calls an urbild. The totem is an urbild, or a vorbild sometimes, but usually it's an urbild. And Cassirer makes the exact same point. Cassirer roots it in Hegel. Hegel is the one who originally says that ritual is the process by which the individual realizes its essence with the universal. Cassirer just transforms it a bit. In this, we have a participation that is immediately lived and felt. It is emotive and kinetic. It establishes a essential identity of being, a Wesenheit. Now, what's important here, and Miki, I think, brings this out more than Cassirer, but Cassirer also makes this point, is that this emotive mythical realm acts as a substructure that underpins the superstructure of thought, such that concepts, ideas of the soul, life, death, society, are founded upon the logic of emotions, which of course then are founded on the logic of images, which are founded in the logic of the imagination. Many institutions, the topic of the next book, the institution of religion, morality, and politics, take such collective representations as their foundations and their ultimate expression. The imagination produces images that form, the form image built. In the translation, it's formed in images, but after a few emails, John is going to take up, I think, the language form image to capture the Japanese. In the Japanese, it's form and image put together. So it makes a difference because that's not a mere image, which is just a, right? So there's a distinction being made in here. The form image is not a copy of a given reality. It is not illustrative, but rather creative. It is forming, building the reality. So it's not an app build, an image of, but rather a building. It's a forming, an image that forms the reality. And of course, Miki, like Cassirer, plays on, brings this out in the word I'm building. And so if you read Cassirer, there's a network of words that have the word build, war build, up build, etc., that make up this tapestry of connections that are very difficult, if not impossible, to translate. Again, I have a series of quotes from Cassirer, but maybe we'll just skip those. The question, however, is the condition of possibility of creativity. When you ask about the condition of possibility of creativity, you're asking after a transcendental character. What is the transcendental character of creativity? Miki is very clear on this. In section 3, the originary, the ur-phenomena of the Einbildung, so the originary phenomena of the imagination, is the free formation, Bildung, that transcends the boundaries of the actual. In section 4, it is the unfolding of that of which takes place by transcending the limits of the actual. In section 6, he says, the logic of imagination is not something prior to creation, but rather is the logic of creation itself. Moreover, the logic of creation must have a transcendental character. Without transcendence, creation is inconceivable. And we can see such transcendence in the first place in the form image of myth. Section 7. In short, a repetition, creation would be unconceivable without some sense or some sort of transcendence. This transcendence, however, can never be a type of mysticism. So neither Miki, nor do I think Nishita, is a mystic. A mystic has to have something beyond. A type of mysticism that goes beyond the image, the phenomena, to some type of noumenal reality beyond it. So a transcendence must be an immanent transcendence. The image creation is thus the immanent transcendence of the actual. An immanent transcendence of the actual. It's the actual that immanently transcends itself. This is the definition that Cassirer gives life. Life is constantly going beyond itself without actually ever breaking from itself, and this is how it becomes objective to itself without breaking from itself. An immanent transcendence. True transcendence, however, is not graspable by way of myth. Why? Because myth is a life in meaning, a life in images. It's an absorbed immediacy. The image is the thing. The Urbild is the totem. I am the totem. There's no distance here. There is no transcendence from the image to itself. Therefore, it is a sheer immanence, even if it's been constructed by original transcendence. This is the source of Miki's critique of Bergson's immanization. The evolution is fun, but it's not real creativity. And this same critique that he applies to Bergson, I think we could apply to Heidegger. And that must sound strange to say that there's no transcendence in Heidegger, but the transcendence is only for Dasein. It's not a really transcendence of the world. And okay, I might be on thin ice there, but I'm willing to defend that thesis. Okay, I had some more Cassirer quotes, but I'm going to skip them too. If there is no mystical transcendence, well, where are we transcending to? And the answer is there's a double transcendence, maybe even a triple transcendence for Miki. There's a transcendence that goes towards the inner, and it is by transcending towards the inner that we become subjects. And then there's a transcendence, which is the same movement, towards the exterior, by which the exterior world is constituted. And this inner and outer transcendence are one and the same coin. I have a quote from Miki for that too, if anybody's interested. However, the originary and fundamental transcendence is a transcendence into nothing, into what I would call sheer possibility, or what I think Cassirer calls sheer possibility. And it is this transcendence into sheer possibility that opens up reality. Now, at one point here, Miki does make a reference to Schelling that I find very fascinating. And I don't have time to unfold this reference. I could do it another time. But the point is that it comes down to the idea of darkness and what Schelling calls the Ungrund, as opposed to an Urgrund, the Urgrund being the absolute. But the Ungrund is a sort of a nonsensical concept. It is and is not a ground. That's what the Un negates and posits. It's sort of a strange concept. I would suggest that this reference to the darkness or to the Ungrund of Schelling is connected to the idea of the form of the formlessness. The deepest meaning of the symbol, Miki Dev tells us, is the symbolization without the symbolized. Symbolization without the symbolized. Time, he then tells us, time is the image or symbol of eternity. Time, as it is the symbol of eternity, and it is not that there is an eternity apart from time as that which is separately symbolized there. Time, as an image of the imagination, is the form of the formlessness, and as such, time is mythical. And as time is mythical, it becomes the fundamental framework, the fundamental ontological framework of the being of all beings. And that was just a series of quotes from Miki. Eternity appears in time by nullifying itself, negating itself. Time symbolizes eternity by negating itself. And so goes the dialectic of history. Now we turn to some practical matters, practical thought. Think here, the second critique. Practical thought transfers universal theory into concrete form. It transforms theory into form through the imagination. Theory is manifest by transfiguring it into an image of the intuition by means of the activist's imagination. For the activist to be able to imagine a theory and to imagine it by transfiguring it into an image of intuition, in order for this to happen, the imagination must somehow already be active at the root of theory itself. In this way, utopia, which is the object of the activist's imagination, is connected to myth. Now, utopia is the imagined community of the future to come, possessing an ideal moral quality, a certain cosmopolitanism. It is, of course, also Thomas More's social political satire. And, as I'm sure you all know, it's the perfect place. But it comes from the Greek word no tope, no place. That is to say, the place of nothing. For the historical will itself is not possible without an act of the productive imagination, while, on the other hand, the imagination can be truly creative only where it is determined, inspired by a living impulse of the will. Thus, historical consciousness rests on the deed and force of the image, on the clarity and certainty with which the eye is able to set before itself an image of a future being, and direct all individual activities towards this image. Here again, the mode of symbolic representation is manifest in its full force and depth, for here, in a manner of speaking, it is the symbol that hastens ahead of reality, showing it the way and initially clearing the path. It does not merely look back on a reality as being and become, but is itself an element in the motif of its becoming. Quote from Cassirer. In short, that's what I think is going on in Miki. Is he's picked up the productive imagination, radicalized it, and posited a new idea of freedom, a radical creative freedom, which then grounds radical creative politics, which would be a new way of dealing with political issues. That's what I have for today. Thank you. Sorry.
I think we have actually a bit of time between the end of the panel and our start for the reception.
Oh, darn. I was hoping there was going to be no questions.
Thanks very much for your talk. I don't know anything about Miki Kiyoshi, but I'm very interested to hear what you have to say. Can you just tell us, you said that he was talking about the possibility for radical creative policy. What was the influence of Miki in subsequent post-war Japan? And I mean that I'm personally more interested not just in the field of philosophy, but in wider social sphere. Did he help to create the radical politics?
I'm not a specialist in Miki, but I know enough to know that you just opened a Pandora's box of interpretations on him. There are some people, I've read some readings that are very uncharitable, that say he sold out, that he was a fascist, and I've heard other ones that John Kremer is more of the view that this is a warning against the fascism that was developing. I've heard a number of things. There's a quote in his diary that I read that I found interesting. He's on a train. I forget where I read this. I've been reading a lot of stuff lately. And he's looking at, he's a train in Japan with all this Western train and Western stuff. And he throws it out, the idea that, are these people mad? There was a time when we would know if someone was mad or not. And now we're in this chaotic time, we don't know. And so he doesn't know if he's doing... I think Miki felt the need to make history. He felt the need, the decisive moment to direct the course of history. But notice there is no Platonic measure by which you can know ahead of time before you act whether your act is going to be good or bad, whether you're going to have the right solution. In the moment of history, in the moment of action, you act, and there is no guarantee that your action is going to unfold to the better. And I think he was very cognizant. That I've skirted your question, but I think that it's an ambiguous situation. I'm not an expert on it, so I couldn't really answer it. But I do feel that my own personal opinion is that he is trying to do something creative. He's trying to lay the foundations for that creativity. I think he sees the danger around him. And I think it's a call to be creative in your actions. Now, I think at the end of his life, he felt finally in the position to do something like that. Whether he felt successful, all the other stuff, I can't answer. Sorry.
Last point, it's really interesting, and I thought normally productive imagination is one thinks of as a subjective act, a subject does have productive imagination. But if it comes to politics and like the social level of history, it seems to me very interesting to think about, and perhaps this is also one aim of Miki, a social practice of imagination. That this political radicalization of productive imagination is a social one. And this is quite closely linked to history. How history is not only individual, but it's a social act. So this, I would like to ask whether your interpretation is in this direction, that the act of productive imagination is also a social act.
Yeah, because I was working quickly and schematically, but at the beginning he does make it clear that the act is always a social act. So the acts are social acts. And I would go even further and argue, I'd agree with what you're saying. And I would go one step further and say that one of the things that might appear puzzling is at one point he says actuality or reality is self-creative. When you look at German idealism, someone like Fichte or some, you got a choice. But you know, Fichte starts out and says, "Look, you can either argue for determinism, or you can argue for freedom. Figure out what type of human being you want to be, and then you'll know which philosophy you have to do it. Because you can't, within as you step into this, you can't use one to defeat the other. They're both coherent systems. And of course, the whole German idealism movement is to try to reconcile that in some way, shape, or form, and they can't. And they can't because they're trying to have something on this side that they will not allow to that side, and so you end up with a two radical world theory, always. I think what he's doing is he's trying to say that the imagination is part of the very fabric of reality itself. The reality itself is imaginary, and that's why the social practice, that's why the individual, that's why this is all happening. It's because he's already rooted the imaginary in life itself, if you will. And I think that's a fascinating step to make.
So is this a turn to the practice itself? Like in Aristotle, I think it's also quite closely linked to the politics. In Aristotle's politics, it's the practice, the social practice itself, which is the move or the process within politics becomes real, the practice itself. And he says that to do exercise for this kind of political practice, we go to the arts and have practices. And
if I had 20-30 more minutes, I think the Aristotelian elements in this text are blatant. I mean, so if you know your Aristotle and you read this, it's just like, okay, he's definitely influenced by Aristotle, sympathetic to Aristotle, developing Aristotle. His reading of Aristotle is very good. That's clear in the language he's picking up, the technique, the poesy, all this language is saturated with Aristotelian elements, and it's clear that he's developing his ideas from a very nuanced and sympathetic reading of Aristotle. That for me is clear, but that would have taken me afar.
We have a question from Yoko-san. Yeah, thank you very much. It seems to me there's a tension between the ontological description of the imagination, the creativity as the part of our very existence, being, and then reality, if you will, in the imagination as the robust process of this existence. And the fact that you bring in history, and there you expect some kind of a concrete change, perhaps. And do you think it would make a difference in the description, when tragically, I mean, actually, there are no outcome So the situation doesn't actually change. And then you still say, yeah, but I imagined myself to do X, Y, and Z. It just didn't work out. So nothing changed, let's say, in history.
That wouldn't be history for Miki. It wouldn't be the type of Ur history that he's talking about, the fundamental soul. That history in which something didn't change or something didn't work out, that would be historia. That would be a history at a different level.
Okay.
But this is this type of history he's talking about only comes about in the moment of transcendence as a fundamental, and at transcendence is by its very nature transformative and therefore creative.
Okay.
And so it's by definition, and that's what real history is. Within that, you can have an ontic history in which I try to give a paper at a conference and it didn't quite work out. But I don't create conferences. I don't create papers. And right. So those are two different senses of history, I think.
Yeah, okay, I can understand. One would be, the ontological ontic difference that you referred to in the notions of history, but what could the history mean then, in the concrete sense? Would then still say you are historical being in the process, when, in fact, the ontic level remained the same?
Just I don't think he's interested in historical beings per se, and being historical,
mm-hmm.
as what does it mean to make history? And that when what is it to make history? And to make history is to change something. I stand up, I sit down, I've changed something. I think he believes that every individual, because there's a certain co-reciprocity between the individual and its environment in Miki and in Cassirer, such that I work on the environment that works on me. I constitute the world that constitutes me.
Yeah.
And so in every speech act, for Cassirer, and I think every act for Miki, I am transforming the world. I am transforming the situation. I have transformed all of you. I've transformed this just by my presence, by my so that type of sensitivity to that structure, that's real history.
Okay.
I think for me, I don't know.
Sorry?
I brought in as much Nishita as I wanted to, but I could see bringing in more. But then my questions were, who's influencing who at this stage? And I wasn't clear in my mind. Again, I'm new to this, so I don't know whether A is coming before B or B is coming before A. And you folks may know this, but I was, this definitely comes. The idea of eternity as the nothing, that definitely is coming from Nishita. For Nishita, the eternal, eternity is a nothing. And he's picking that up. And then there's these other elements I could clearly see that he's bringing in. And so I brought in as much as I needed. But yes, I think there is a great more that... harmony in their thinking or influence, but I don't know which way it's going. That's my only problem. My sense is actually, my gut is telling me that it's going Miki versus Nishita. That's just my gut. Only because when I read Nishita's account of I see the result, but I don't see the mechanics of getting there. Whereas in Miki, I sense the dirty mechanics of getting there. I mean, I don't know if that makes sense to you, but I sense how he's struggling to get to this idea from fundamental principles. Whereas in Nishita, it feels to me sometimes, maybe I haven't read enough, that this is sort of an idea of taken out of the box already completed. It doesn't have that nastiness of an idea in progress for me. But that's just me.
All in progress.
We have two more questions. I would say that we have four.
I just wanted to ask if you can say something about the function of the body, or if, like, logical imagination is, let's say, realized within body practices, as what brings together the change of history and, like, ontological dimension of freedom. So
the corporality of it?
The link between the two, or if you can integrate it otherwise.
Well, that, you folks are asking a lot of 20-minute questions.
Yeah.
I intentionally left that level out, only because it would add just constantly a lot of extra things. But the materiality, of course, is the individualizing element of this, and that's what makes it individual and unique, right? So the idea is the form image becomes an embodied idea. The action is an embodied action. The affect is an embodied affect. The dynamic is always an embodied aspect. But then at the end of the day, the difference between form and matter here is just a transcendental division of validity, and not an actual division. That's true for Cassirer as it is for Miki. So, yeah. I mean, then but I don't think you would get that rich. I mean, there is a sense of the lived body, the flesh, aka Merleau-Ponty, etc. But I don't think he develops it on that level. It's more of a Marxist materiality, if I can.
Ideally, this is a direct question, so this is a 20-minute answer, then feel free to say so. I think we thank you for a very suggestive paper, but the joining of Miki with Cassirer does bring some new Kantian biases which you seem comfortable with, and that as a Heideggerian, I might be a little more questioned, I might be a little suspicious of. So to make this direct, what do you think would be, what motivates the initial movement of intrinsic transcendence?
What
motivates the movement of the initial movement of it? So if identity and subjectivity is going to be a self-created process that comes through this circling over of different forms of transcendence, starting with intrinsic transcendence, we know how this is motivated in Heidegger. Could you say how this is motivated in Miki or Cassirer?
I think that my sense is that Miki and Cassirer would both say the question's still formed.
But then to me that suggests a cognitive basis.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how are you going to link this with Heidegger, where the basis of this is going to be anxiety and an understanding of death?
Well, the same question could be, first of all, I'm not anti-Heideggerian. Rather the contrary. And two, I think Heidegger would have the same problem. The Heidegger would be plagued by the same question. Why should my being towards end pose any type of anxiety to me?
Yeah, the question is right about him, but Heidegger would be comfortable with that. Okay, but this is a paper for our time, but I was just curious. Is there anything explicit about what motivates the first movement of intrinsic transcendence, or it just seems...
No, there's nothing that motivates it, because that's the thing. There can't be a motivation behind it, because if there's a motivation, then the productive imagination would be in some way, shape, or form determined, and therefore limited.
Yeah, but to me that sounds like an argument by definition, that we're starting with this idea, and we'll sacrifice whatever it takes to keep the productive imagination intact. And Heidegger is going to have something that I see, just personally, more interesting in conjunction with Japanese philosophy in terms of more profound or more complex relationship to the separation between self and world.
No, I think that the world is already expressive.
Certainly for Heidegger as well, yeah. And for Cassirer as well?
Yeah.
Yeah, even though I'm...
Expression, I mean, I skipped a whole bunch of stuff on expression, but expression is the key here, and expression is, for Cassirer, and I think for Miki, is not unique to the human being. It's more profound. And so the life is always already expressive.
Yeah, you know, Heidegger and Cassirer and Hildes would totally agree with that. But they would allow for that because it's based on finitude. How can the world express itself when my imagination is producing it? I mean, yes, it's the result, it's a reciprocal result between the two. But in a certain sense, you know, am I going too far to say that actually the world might be expressing itself, but I'll never catch up to it, or I'll never know that because I'm not already busy catching up with my own formulations of it?
Yes.
Okay. Good enough for me.
Okay, well, thank you.
Thank you very much. And